I have never had the chance to collaborate with Thibaut, but maybe it's not too late yet. And so I will discuss. I was asked, in fact, to give an account of a subject that to which Thibaut contributed early on, both in terms of the subject itself, it was just the beginning of it, and also in terms of his career, because it was among his first work, but it was a very important contribution. And then the later related developments that have come from a different direction, as I will explain. So these two papers mainly, maybe there are some other few, but it's mostly, it was in fact his thesis, the doctorat d'etat, so his PhD thesis, in which, as we see this abstract from a review paper of some years later, it is said that a black hole is qualitatively and quantitatively similar to a fluid bubble, possessing a negative surface tension and endowed with finite values of the electrical conductivity and of the shear and bulk viscosities. So this is the late 70s, and in the 70s, as we all know, people had been starting to understand the black holes as thermodynamic objects with the entropy and temperature, and so building from some previous work that had mostly to do with the global properties, Damour was the first, I think, to extend this interpretation of black holes to a fluid dynamic one, so in just not just global quantities like the total entropy, the total energy, but local quantities on the horizon could also be given a thermodynamic or fluid dynamic interpretation. And so the way it was done, I will quickly recap here. If you have this, it's supposed to be the horizon of the black hole, and you take a foliation in time, constant time slices, which evolve then along the horizon, and this evolution is described by a vector L, which is normal to the horizon and also tangent because it's null. And then if you complete the normal basis of the basis of the normal space to the closed surface by another null vector K, which can be normalized. So this fixes completely this basis. And then you can associate a number of geometric quantities to the setup, which characterize the shape and the extrinsic geometry of this curve. And so the mainly there is the covariant derivative of the null field with respect to itself, which gives the nu, which is the inaffinity parameter of the null geodesics generated from L. Then there is this tensor theta, it's symmetric to tensor, which is basically the here gamma is the induced metric on the closed surface. And the surface is transported by the vector L, and so under this transport, the metric is deformed. This deformation is described by this tensor theta, which is decomposed into a traceless part and a trace part, which is this. And then finally, there is a vector on the tangent vector to the surface, which is basically this combination describes how the two null vectors of the basis are deformed when you go move along the surface. And then the discovery of Thibaut was that when you project the Einstein equations in this component along the null vector and along the surface, the closed equal time surface, this gives some equations which have been dubbed the Damour-Navier-Stokes, because they have the same form as the Navier-Stokes equations, and they become precisely these equations when you reinterpret these geometric quantities appropriately. So this omega alpha becomes the momentum density, nu, the inaffinity parameter, is interpreted as the pressure, and the sigma and theta are interpreted as the shear tensor and the expansion rate. And then with this, these are exactly the Navier-Stokes equation with some forcing term, which comes from the bulk stress energy tensor. So this 1 over 16 pi is needed to appropriately normalize so that when you integrate over the whole the horizon, this reduces to the total angular momentum. This fixes this normalization. And then, because in this equation you can read off the transport coefficients, which appear in the Navier-Stokes equations, there are two, the shear viscosity and the bulk viscosity, and they are both given by this value, 1 over 16 pi, except with the bulk viscosity there is a minus sign. You see here that they have opposite signs. And here I have stated, just for this slide, I've reinstated the dimensionful quantities to see what are the dimensions, but in the later will be always set to 1. So what happens is it interpreted the gravity equations as a fluid equations, but this fluid is a fictitious fluid because it has a negative bulk viscosity. I should say also, yeah, this as you see, Tibor called this a fluid bubble. Other people have called it a membrane, but fluid bubble is more appropriate because it has a pressure and not a tension. In fact, if you interpret it as a tension, it would be negative. As Thibault explained in the original paper, this is needed because a normal fluid has a bubble, has a membrane, has tension to counteract the pressure, whereas the horizon of the black hole has to counteract the gravitational attraction, and so the negative tension should be negative, but indeed it's a pressure. And similarly, the bulk viscosity is negative for a reason which you can understand gravitationally. It's the fact that the horizon is just marginally stable in the sense that if you move just a bit inside or outside, you will fall into the black hole or go away. So in a way, it makes sense from gravity that it is negative. But nevertheless, when you try to give a fluid mechanic interpretation, it is kind of problematic that it's negative, and so you cannot really see this as a real fluid. And what is striking also is that you get exact non-relativistic equation from a fully relativistic theory, which is GR. There is no approximation, but still you get non-relativistic equations. And finally, there is another component of the Einstein equations. If you project along the null directions, you get another equation. This theta is the expansion parameter, so this is related to the entropy production. When you associate the area of the horizon to the entropy, you get such an equation. And this is also slightly unexpected because you would normally expect only these terms, which tells you that the entropy increases with time in a way dictated by the hydrodynamics, so with the square of the viscosity, with the viscosity proportional to the square of the shear tensor and the expansion. But there is this additional second derivative, which is related to the fact that, in fact, we are evaluating things on the horizon, the event horizon, which is a teleological concept, which means you need to know the evolution of the space all the way to future infinity to know. And so this term is needed, in fact, to ensure that these things equilibrate to infinity, but nevertheless, it's not what you get directly from the Navier-Stokes equation. So there is a slight discrepancy. This tau is, in this formalism, turns out to be given by the inverse of the pressure. And then, interestingly, also if I define an entropy density by dividing by the surface area of the black hole, the Bekenstein-Hawking formula tells us that this is just 1 over 4. And if you divide the entropy, which was 1 over 16 pi, by this 1 over 4, you get 1 over 4 pi. So this result was already in the 1979 paper. So what do we want to say about this? First of all, we have used two out of the three possible projections of the Navier-Stokes equation, of the Einstein equations. One component is has not been used, and this would give additional constraints on the on the equations that also are not in the Navier-Stokes equations. Also, later it was realized that by Gorgouillon, who is in the audience, that you can generalize these equations, in fact, not only on an horizon, but for any foliated hypersurface, even not null. But if it's not null, then you have to couple more degrees of freedom. In a way, you need to have more quantities to describe the evolution of these shapes, of these surfaces. And so this a kind of fluid interpretation, maybe also coupled with other degrees of freedom, hasn't been given yet. That would be interesting, I think. And then from this original paper, there was evolved what has been called the membrane paradigm, which was used as a way to kind of practical tool to solve general relativity problem, mostly in astrophysical applications. And basically, the idea is that you can use it as a tool to separate the dynamics, what happens in the region far from the horizon and close to the horizon. So you can cover the horizon by a surface, which has been called the stretched horizon. And on this stretched horizon, you solve fluid equations. And sometimes it can be simpler or more intuitive than to fully simulate the dynamic of the black hole. But I will not go into these applications, because instead I want to discuss how this fluid gravity correspondence arose then again, but coming from independently, in fact, of this original work, from the gauge gravity duality of the ADS-CFT correspondence, which was discovered in the end of the 90s from Aldacena and Witten and other people. And for this presentation, I will just give a very sketchy cartoon picture of the duality. The duality tells that if you are in this space, which is supposed to represent anti-de Sitter space, in this space there is a radial coordinate, and there is a boundary, a conformal boundary at infinity. And then when you go into, so the metric expands to infinity in this coordinate. And then as you go into the interior, if you are in the, there can be a black hole in the interior. And so it is cut off by some horizon at a radial distance h. And basically the statement of the correspondence, if there is a field theory that lives on the boundary of the space, and you can compute the correlators in this field theory by doing some computation of fluctuating fields in the bulk. So in particular, if you're interested in stress energy tensor, you can consider metric excitations or graviton excitations, and then this computation will tell you the correlator. And also if you have a black hole, this is supposed to tell you that the field theory is not in the vacuum, but it's in a thermal state at the temperature given by the black hole temperature. And then, so in the early, late 90s and early 2000, people have just discovered this and were very busy computing all kind of correlators. And I, with the collaboration with Stone and Starinets, was interested in computing the absorption rate from the horizon, extending some previous work of Igor Klebanov, who did it for the extremal brain, which means at zero temperature. And we wanted to extend it to finite temperature. And then we realized that the correspondence was given a form for the correlator of this type. Which is in fact the form of a hydrodynamic correlator. So this is basically what hydrodynamics predicts for a sound wave. If you have a sound wave, this is a shear excitation. Sound wave also, but its form is slightly different. The important thing is that there is this pole, which tells you that there is something that is a diffusion pole. Right, so, and there is a diffusion coefficient whose value comes from the correspondence. And this is obtained by, if you expand the stress energy tensor in this way, if you have a perfect fluid and then corrections where these coefficients appear, the same coefficients as I had before, the diffusion constant that appears in the pole is in fact related to eta by this way, and the computation gave that the diffusion constant is 1/4 pi t, and then eta over s is again 1/4 pi, except in this computation now the bulk viscosity is zero, is not this minus 1/16 pi as before. And this fluid has a particular equation of state, which comes from the fact that it's a conformal field theory. So what I want to stress here is that this is not a fictitious fluid anymore, but it just it comes from the high temperature phase of a well-defined theory that has a holographic dual. For example, the simplest case is when the dual theory is n equal 4 super Young Mills, you just have ADS 5 without anything else. And then this corresponds to this particular coefficients. And one consequence is that because it's a well-defined theory, the transport coefficients have to be positive, because in fact they can be expressed as from the Kubo formulas in terms of field theory correlators. And if the field theory is well-defined, unitary, and has all the nice properties, then these formulas will tell you that these coefficients have to be positive. And so in fact they are positive or zero. Also, the hydrodynamic equations that we get in this way are not exact, because this is just the first order in an expansion, but you could continue with the adding terms that have higher, more and more derivatives, and you will get more and more transport coefficients. So at first order there are just two, but next order there are already 10, and they increase very fast. All these coefficients will depend on the details of the theory, just the shear viscosities. Universal, at least in Einstein gravity. It won't be universal anymore when you add modifications to gravity, like higher derivative corrections to gravity. This was proven in these two papers, and in particular this paper of Iqbal and Liu tried to make a connection to the old membrane paradigm by showing that basically the argument was that the shear viscosity computed at the boundary could be computed at any point in the bulk, even you can transport it to the horizon and read it there. And so, yeah, it could be defined as a horizon quantity or a boundary quantity indifferently. Basically, because it can be obtained from the equation of a massless field in ADS. If you try to do it for other coefficients, however, you don't get the same equations, and so there is a modification depending if you read it in the boundary or some other point. The difference with the membrane paradigm is that in this case the fluid does not live on the horizon, but in fact is dual to the entire bulk. So the dynamics of the fluid is dual to the entire bulk dynamics. And so a solution of the hydrodynamic equation can be lifted to a solution of the Einstein equations. And this was implemented very nicely in this paper, then in 07, by these authors, where they implemented this scheme. They start from an equilibrium solution of gravity, which can correspond to a black brain, and you have to start from a boosted black brain from reasons that will become clear, because then this gives some solutions which depend on a number of parameters, and then you promote these parameters. At first they are just constants in the original solution, just like a static black hole will have temperature or chemical potential, or when you boost it you also add the velocity. Then these parameters are promoted to space-time dependent quantities, which you can expand in derivatives around some point, say around the origin. Then what happens when these parameters become space-time dependent, the solution is no longer a solution of the equation, but can be corrected in order that it remains a solution. And this is a procedure that you can do order by order in epsilon, which counts the number of derivatives. And so in this way, you get the hydrodynamic solution of Einstein equations. Then the solutions, if you are in asymptotically ADS space, they will all have the same behavior at the boundary. And if you read the boundary behavior, you extract the stress energy tensor. And since the metric is corrected order by order, also the stress energy tensor will be corrected order by order. So you get the procedure to systematically derive the hydrodynamic equations. Then later it was even realized that actually this scheme can be applied in full generality. In fact, you don't even need to be in ADS. You could be also in flat space. In flat space, there is no boundary, but you don't need that either. The boundary can be imposed on a generic time-like hypersurface. And then there was this period when people talked about the Ricci flat fluid correspondence. So why you can do that? Because it seems that I have been telling you before that it's important that there is this duality, which there is a real fluid which comes from the fact that there is a dual, a real field theory dual to the bulk. In the case of flat space, we don't have a holographic duality. There is no real theory. But this, as a formal scheme, it can still be applied, and it leads to some results. So you can ask, what does it lead to? So the reason you can do it is that basically, take a hypersurface in any space, and the momentum and Hamiltonian constraints imply the conservation of the Brown-York stress-energy tensor with some equation of state. And then there is one remaining equation which is used to solve for the radial evolution of the metric. So in this scheme, you use all of the Einstein equations. And this is automatically conserved. In fact, it's automatically conserved for any constant C. So there is you can always add the term proportional to the induced metric on the surface. So there is an ambiguity actually in this scheme. In the true holographic correspondence, this is fixed by requiring that this remains finite when you go to the boundary, because otherwise, normally, it's divergent. But if you are just in a finite surface, there is no reason to fix it to any value, so it remains a bit undetermined. But most of the time, you set it to zero, unless you have a specific reason to do otherwise. And so you just take the canonical Brown-York stress-energy tensor.
So this T is scalar, and if you can be polar.
Yeah.
What is the t squared here? Is it scalar t or temperature t?
Yeah, this is a trace of t squared, and this is t squared traced. This t is the bulk t that enters in the Einstein equations. So you can write a generic ansatz for this metric in this form. This is written in Eddington-Finkelstein coordinates, so corresponding to incoming object trajectories into the horizon, and this parametrized by three functions whose form has to be determined on the static equilibrium solution by looking at the Einstein equations. So, but this G and F are functions which contain in some way the parameters, the mass, and all the parameters of the black hole. And then you boost it with the velocity UA, so this gives the boosted black metric. And we want to be at a specific time-like surface, so sigma C, which lives at a fixed constant radius. And we impose Dirichlet boundary conditions at this point. So we fix that these functions are equal to 1 at RC. And then you can read off from this form the fluid parameters. So the pressure will be given in some way, the energy density from some other way at the cutoff surface, whereas the entropy and temperature, as usual, are read off from the horizon values of these quantities. And so the scheme, then you can apply it. You can, again, make this time-dependent, space-time-dependent, and iterate the Einstein equations. So what do you get from this? For example, if you are in ADS, then these functions take this form, where you see the usual blackening factor of a black hole, and RH is the parameter which will become space-time-dependent. And when you run the machinery, you find that eta takes this form, So it's the horizon radius divided by the cutoff radius, whereas zeta is still zero. So you may be surprised at this point because eta was supposed to be not changing. In fact, eta over s is still not changing, but eta itself is running. So it is a function of this RC. And this can be interpreted as a kind of RG flow of the transport coefficients, because if you take this surface at a constant, at radius not infinity, in the IHES correspondence, even though now we are in flat space, but no, okay, this is in IHES, sorry. In IHES, the radius is dual to the energy scale of the dual theory. So if you are at finite radius, it's like you are looking at, you are doing some kind of RG flow. You are supposed to have integrated out the degrees of freedom outside the surface. And this integrating out will generate an RG flow, which can induce also some RG flow of the transport coefficients. And this is a simple example, but one can do more complicated examples. And this has been studied also in numerous situations.
5 minutes?
Oh.
At most.
What?
At most.
Okay, I'm almost done. Actually, so as I said, this was in IHES, but you can apply it to flat space. It's even simpler because the functions are simpler. What you find, strangely, is that this, if you apply the formulas from before, the energy density evaluated from, in this case, gives zero. So this is a fluid with zero density, but still it has pressure. This has been called the Rindler fluid because the Rindler, it's a Rindler space-time with just the local horizon. It's not very physical maybe, but nevertheless, you still find sensible transport quantities and sensible hydrodynamics. The eta is equal to one in this case, and zeta is still equal to zero, even though its fluid is incompressible, so there is no zeta, but there is another quantity which plays the same role, so I call it zeta as well. And these are the equations of this fluid, which are just the Navier-Stokes equations. And in fact, here an important point is that when you go near the horizon, you can take different limits. In fact, you can rescale the variables in a relativistic way. So this just gives the normal derivative expansion, because each derivative will be rescaled by an epsilon, independently if it's space of time. And then to promote it to a symmetry of the gravity situation, you have to rescale the parameters in this way. And so the RC and RH both go to zero, but in the same way. So you're going near the horizon, both with the horizon itself is going to zero, the surface that you consider is going to zero, but the ratio remains constant. But you can also do a non-relativistic scaling, where you rescale time and space differently. Then you also need to rescale the velocity. This is the symmetry, the scaling symmetry of the non-relativistic Navier-Stokes equations. And this can also be realized, but just by taking a different scaling of this quantity, in which case the horizon radius goes to zero faster than the cutoff surface. And so this shows that, in fact, going to the horizon is not by itself sufficient to give a non-relativistic limit. It depends on how you take the limit. And in more general spacetimes, one can also realize other symmetries like Schrödinger symmetry, which is the symmetry of the Schrödinger equations, or Lifshitz scaling symmetries, or Carolian symmetries that we have heard about in the yesterday, actually. And so this has also generated a lot of work, but I cannot give a review here because there is not enough time. Very quickly, there is a canonical way here to define an entropy current, because the lines of x constant are null geodesics in this parametrization of the metric. So they can be used to transport quantities from the boundary to the horizon. It's a canonical map from the boundary to the horizon. So if you pull back using this map the area element of the horizon, you get a current on the boundary or on the surface that you're looking at. And this current will have this form. It's equilibrium current plus corrections. You can determine the location of the horizon in this scheme order by order in the derivative expansion. So it's, even though the horizon, as I said, it's a teleological concept, but order by order in the derivative expansion, it's actually determined locally. And you find that this divergence of the entropy current is always positive, as expected. So it is, again, sensible hydrodynamics. However, when you go away from the derivative expansion, you are far away from equilibrium. It's still not unclear how to extend this, because then you have to really deal with this issue of what is the horizon, and should I take the apparent horizon or the true event horizon? And it has not yet been completely understood. So to conclude, I would say that now, thanks to the gauge gravity duality, we have a more systematic understanding of the various ways in which fluid dynamics is related to gravity. And that despite the fact that these two things are tantalizingly similar, but the membrane paradigm is not exactly the same as the fluid gravity correspondence, but the relation between the two is not yet completely clear. So notice that in fluid gravity, the fluid parameters are given by the radial evolution of the metric, which is not the same as the time evolution. They are completely different things. In the membrane paradigm of Damour, the two are linked, because it's both the evolution along the horizon gives both the time evolution and the definition itself of what are the fluid quantities. And the parameters also are not the same. If you take the pressure as defined in the membrane paradigm, will not be the same pressure as in fluid gravity, but it will be corrected by higher order corrections, order by order. So we might conjecture that perhaps membrane paradigm is a sort of resummation to all orders of the fluid gravity correspondence, but it shouldn't be a standard resummation. In fact, it has been shown that if you try to resum the hydrodynamic expansion, first of all, it's an asymptotic series, so it's not so obvious, but to the extent that you can do it in some limited situation, it was shown that what it gives, you can recover the quasi-normal modes of the black hole. This was this paper in 13. But then on the other hand, it was also shown that the membrane paradigm, using the stretched horizon approach, it fails to capture at least the very high excited quasi-normal modes of the black hole. So in some sense, this resummation should not should be some other scheme of resummation. Also, it's not clear why you could get negative bulk viscosity. So perhaps it should be just a formal way of resumming. But it's just speculation. I don't have an answer at this point. So I will finish by saying happy birthday to Thibault.
Other questions? Thibault?
In another part of my PhD, which was not a PhD thesis, actually.
I was not.
Test data. But I discussed also that some of the field equations of relativity were equivalent to minimizing an entropy production on the black hole.
All right.
A la Prigogine. Is it a theme that appeared in ADS CFT to minimize entropy production?
Not exactly. There has been some discussion about the fact that if you try to construct an entropy current and ask that its divergence is positive, then this is equivalent to, it puts the same constraints on the theory as requiring that there is an equilibrium partition function in a generic background metric. Mm-hmm. So it's not the same thing, but yeah, it's vaguely related.
Okay, there's another question.
So there are some old works by Arnold that formulates fluid dynamics in terms of like geodesics and the group of diffeomorphisms and things like that. Is there some relation within that with this membrane paradigm program?
It's a good question. Not directly, that not that I know. Yeah. This was for just non-relativistic for the Navier-Stokes, I think. Yeah. Yeah. No, I don't know how to relate.
Okay, are there more questions? If not, then we will go on to the next speaker. Thanks again.